Ehen, all right. So I already read you the uppermost parts. He want to be my lover. I say your father. I repeat, I'm your father. That's the guy. And then Simi is like, oh, Simi Siwala. I don't enter Waiyawa. Oh, I tell my mama. My mama tell my papa. She say Simi Siwala. And then that's when the chorus comes in. So basically, Simi tells on this guy. She tells on him to mom and dad. The equivalent of that in the Christian community would be, okay, we've got this like guy that won't leave us alone, so we go to God in prayer. And the plight of Simi in this song is, don't fall in love with me. You're not in a good place if you do that. And that is exactly my plight and the plight of Christian women to these men, given that the Christian is an evangelistic human being. And she longs that people should not perish, but come to a knowledge of God, because God gives us his desires, right? The Lord does not delight in the death of him who dieth. It is therefore safer for these men to just, like, devil worshippers, we love that you're obsessed with the church, because your rituals make you obsessed with the church. But don't frequent the church for romantic activity. You are supposed to fight with us all the way up until the end. Wheat will grow among tares. Offenses must come. Woe to the one through whom the offenses must come. The Lord sets apart everything for its purposes, including the wicked for the day of trouble. Therefore, you will always be around all the way up until the second coming of Jesus Christ. You're just gonna roll around and do a thing, and so there is no extincting you until God's second coming. So do your job, because you are supposed to. It's God's purpose that you should be the wicked set apart for the day of trouble. You are Judases whose condemnation have been written about long ago. But one thing that you ought to do to give yourself longevity on earth, juice it until you get to the age of 95, is avoid Christian. If you want to get to the ripe old age of 89, properly avoid Christian women. Avoid them. Like, do not allow it to understand us as your Achilles heel. There is a speech lag there. I apologize. It's the only phone I have. Gauge us as your Achilles heel. We are your weakness. We are the thing that will be the end of you. Do you understand? We are the thing that you're going to convert into a Cleopatra as Anthony. You will worship us until you die in that idolatry. You will shorten your own lifespan. Your existence on the earth is imperative for God's purposes to be fulfilled, for you are the wicked for the day of the trouble of the church. We get it. So you're not going anywhere until then, but to make sure that you're not one of those that gets snuffed out and cut short at just the age of 29, don't look at Christian girls. Do not do it. I promise you, they will be the end of your life because of the level of obsession that you're going to walk in concerning them until you get killed. So avoid Christian women. Like, I'm literally out here giving occult practitioners advice. To buy time on earth. To buy time. So you are here at least by the second coming of Jesus. If you won't repent, if you won't give your life to Christ, you better at least juice the earth of all of its years, that you might have less time in eternity. So don't die at 31. Don't die at 40. Die at 80. And the way that you die at 80 as a devil worshiper is by avoiding Christian girls. Otherwise, they will make you lose your mind. I promise you right now. So this is Simi. She's like, soldier go, soldier come, soldier do what do you want, but don't fall in love with me. Soldier go, soldier come, soldier do what do you want, but don't fall in love with me. So this woman is pleading with this guy. Run in the occult, spin on the spot like Itopo, run circles around the church, make us fall asleep, sneeze, go to spiritual war with us, throw us death curses, hey, go and grab women in this world and sleep with 10,000 of them, priding yourself in being a Casanova. Do what you want. Don't fall in love with a godly woman, because you gonna get hurt. But what is the response? The response is literally like that of false. The moment you have found this woman, you feel as if, oh, I'm not letting her go. Because, like I said, many women have done excellently, but she surpasses them all. Nobody compares. And granted that no one compares, you will pursue her unto death. Because it don't get no better. Sorry for you. Listen to the lyrics of False in this song over here. Ne? I love the song with all of my brain. Do you understand? And my heart and all of my, like, follicles on my head. go listen to it on YouTube. It's really delightful. It's decent. It's modest. It's not going to slap you silly with profanity or lustful or sensual imagery or anything of that nature. It's one of those good old good songs that are secular that you can actually check out. It goes, oh yeah, stand at attention. I love this song. I just love it so much. So this is False so rapping, okay? Oh yeah, stand at attention. I'm talking to you. You are respond. Emi kunanrin mesan. I don't know what that means. It's Nigerian. The language that they speak in Nigeria there, I don't know what it is exactly. How can you be asking me question? You know they look. So, okay, I'm going to just read the lyrics instead of trying to sound like False, alright? Largely English, so mostly I understand what's being said here. Oh yeah, stand at attention. That's basically stand and give attention. You know how soldiers stand up and like, pay attention. So, an authority that he commands. When he walks in the room, because they get powerful, these men, they become very powerful using occult magic. So essentially they're well respected. Prophet Lovi, the Lord has used Prophet Lovi a lot because the man that is gawking at me is like Prophet Lovi. Everybody regards that man. He is well regarded, well respected, honored in the body of Christ as a false shepherd, not the real deal. Deceived Christians that are gathering for themselves a great number of teachers to teach them what their itching ears want to hear, listen to him. And on top of that, in the occult, he's likely very well respected too. He has made a lot of money. He is a well respected man. He's got power. So they can command attention in a room when they walk in. However, you're not interested in him. And that's the thing that makes him wonder, but like, I am Prophet Lovi, a man like that. Like, but I am, except a godly woman is not gonna want you. A godly woman is not gonna want you because you're not of God. And your outward glory, your outward beauty, and all of this attention that you command in the room when you walk in is feckless, given that you are working for the kingdom of darkness. Your righteous works are like filthy rags. Nothing of you has value and honor because of who you work for. You are wasting the image of God in you and the glory that God gave you to indeed command that much attention. The stature that God gave you. Work for him and be respectable in him. You decided to squander it to the devil. You gave the thing that God naturally gave you, that countenance, to the devil. And so now in the wrong environment, you are respected in the wrong space. And a Christian woman gets that and is not interested, therefore, in a way that other worldly women will spaz over you. Or lost Christian women, or compromising Christian women. Oh yeah, stand at attention. I'm talking to you, you are respond. So I'm talking to you, you better respond. Oh, stand at attention. I'm talking to you, respond. And then I don't know what that other sentence means. And then she's like, how can you be asking me question? Like, you don't question me. Like, I'm talking to you. You're gonna do what I want you to do. That's how forceful they are. They are so used to just casting spells and getting what they want that they think they can do this thing in the lives of Christian women. All we respond to them by saying is, please just leave me alone. I'm your fool. Like, you might be a soldier for the kingdom of darkness and a very prolific one, but I don't want you. How can you be asking me question? You know they look, okay, you know they look face so. It's like you don't know my name, no, right? So he's like, why in the world are you looking at me like that? It's like you don't know who I am, because apparently he's that important. Self-importance is a big, and then mofeka my date though. Okay, I don't know what this is, but date though, I suspect that's how we speak in Africa. We mix our own tongues with English, and in the region that we're at, we get what we're saying. Like, kibwaso anakadamo, I finish with English. Like, a South African would get what I just said, but somebody else would be like, what? However, you would get just like the English part, what's being said there. So I imagine that what's been said here is, when he says mofeka my date though, I'm here asking you for a date. So, don't you know who I am? I'm here asking you for a date. Ayo, boyfriend, oli to nami say no. Okay, he's like, I'm basically asking you to be my boyfriend, and yet you're busy saying no. Boyfriend, oli to nami say no. I'm asking you to be my boyfriend, but you're busy telling me no. I'm asking you to be your boyfriend, and you're telling me no. I think that's what that is. I'm not from Nigeria, so I can't tell. I can't confirm it. See, I stand, I balance, you stand, you balance. Okay, so he's basically saying you're standing there and I'm standing here. Because I'm a chief lieutenant, I cannot be your servant. Because I'm a chief lieutenant, I cannot be your servant, right? That's the next part. So he is so lofty in the occult that he feels as if though Ain't nobody gonna say no to me. And I am not gonna be your servant. You're gonna be my servant rather. You know, see my car. It's German. You know, see my car. It's German. You know, see the swag. Gallant. See many, they claim my madam. But I know these babes from Adam. They just want to follow the ladder. They know that nobody is better. Goodness, like, this song is just, it's so killer. I would play it, but, you know, copyright type thing. So let me just go back up there. He says, I'm a chief lieutenant, I can't be your servant. Do you see my car? It's German. Do you see my swag? It's gallant. So see many, they claim my madam. So many women claim that they're my woman. But I don't know these women from Adam, essentially from all the way back to Adam in the garden. I don't know who they are. It's so funny. I'm sorry, I gotta open for my cat. He's like, see, these women may be claiming that they're my madam, but I don't know them all the way back to the days of Adam. They just want to follow the ladder. They know that nobody is better. So they want to follow the height that I am at. And they know, but they know that these guys, I've already told you that this is a strategy that is pursuing me. Like, guys that are very, like, longed after, wanted by many women in the world, and even deceived women in the church, busy trying to knock on my door, because they're devil worshippers. They have gotten powers from the occult, etc. And they, like, you see, so many women want to be my madam, and I don't know them from the days of Adam. All they want to do is climb the ladder, but, because they don't know that there ain't anybody better. There ain't nobody better. There's nobody better than me. I'm the guy in the room. Like, everybody wants me. So just take me. Like, I am the guy that everybody, you know what I told you about Prophet Lovie? There's a woman apparently that literally, like, took her children from her state where she was at, packed them up, took them out of school, and moved to California because she was thoroughly determined to marry Prophet Lovie. Joined his church because she wanted to marry Prophet Lovie. That's how much he was wanted by women. And then he chose one in particular, that prophetess what lady. Yeah, so essentially you're supposed to feel all honored when you have made that position where a man, every woman wants him, but then he chooses you. And then he looks at you like, confused when you say no to him on some. Hey, so many women have called me have called themselves my madam, but I don't know them from Adam. They just want to climb the ladder because I'm the baddest, and you don't get to say no to that. It's so arrogant. Pride before a fall, humility before a fall. That is what the Bible has to say. They don't know that no one is better. She say, why him they flex like here be gym? She say why him they flex here? Basically, why they flexing like the gym? Make he day hope day there they dream. Okay, why him they flex like here be gym? Why him they flex like here be? Okay, whoa, okay. Why are they making him flex like this here is a gym? And she says, why him they flex? Okay, make he day hope day there. Make he day hope day 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 dream. Okay, so he makes these women hope that whatever it is that they dream becomes true or something of that nature. And then this woman says that, oh yeah, she say, why him they flex he here like Jim? Make he day day like yeah they dream. Is it by force to be with him? Is this a military regime? This is the woman speaking. This is see me. She's not singing, but he is narrating her in the third person. So she's basically saying, why him they flex? Why him they flex like here be gym? Make he day hope day day they dream. Is it by force to be with him? Is this a military regime? So basically this woman is like, why in the world are these women trying to flex you like you're in the gym and trying to like make their dreams come true with you? Is it by force to be with you? Is this a military regime? All right, so that's what she's asking him, like, I don't want to be with you. Is this a military regime? And she's asking, what's the big deal with you? So this guy that's wanted by everybody, see me, is responding by saying, it's not even that intense, really. Why are the women in this world flexing you like it's the gym? You're not that great. Indeed, exactly what Christian women are saying. You're lost. You are lost. And because you are lost, you are unattractive to a godly woman. So while they might indeed dream to be with you, not me. And again, you can't force me to be with you. What is this, a military regime? And then False's response is, I be soldier man, I say I stand at ease. I'm a soldier man, I say stand at ease. So he says to her, be at ease. So she's out here dissing him on some, I don't want to be with you, and I don't get why all these women want you. And then he's like, at ease. So arrogant. This is literally how men in the occult do with Christian women. Like, they need to stop. Like, Blom, you're gonna be mine. Like, what's love got to do? Got to do with it. They don't care. They will get you come hell or high water. Sorry, Dola, me fi giba e lady. It's only me. There is no competi. So he's basically saying I got money, and he's also saying it's only me, and there is no competition. I'll make it rain like it's confetti. So essentially, he's saying I got money, and on top of that, don't nobody say no to me. All right? Do you understand what I'm saying? Yeah. This is not the guy saying I'm a soldier. When I say stand, people be at ease. I got money, all right? And it's only me that's the baddest. There is no competition. And I make it rain like it's confetti. Shomo Paris Shoti Lobiri. Long story short, I will take you to, I think that says, I will take you to Paris. I will show you everything. I will take you and your Ebi. I don't know what Ebi is. I don't know. Like, basically your whole family, maybe. I don't know. I will take you and your Ebi. No mess na wahala. Yeah, and then he says, I'm a Hitler. I am a Bacha. So he's naming oppressors of history that took things by force, all right? You better respect. They run the town. So he says, you better respect me because I run the town. That's people in the occult. They understand that they've done so much in the darkness, and they have commanded so much respect that when a Christian woman is like, no, they're like, hey, I run the town. I'm like Hitler. I'm like a Bacha. You must respect me. I run the town. Even Darego no fit turn me down. So I don't know who Darego is, but apparently he can't turn this soldier down because they become that pompous. They become that arrogant when they gain occult power. It's a pride game. See weapon way you carry. Come and be general in my army, mommy. All right. So this dude is like telling this woman, look, you can't say no to me. And she's listening to him speak. In the music video, he's busy following her around in the market, like where they buy groceries, like fruits and vegetables and what have you. And she's just like, leave me alone, leave me alone. And he's just busy following her, pursuing her. This is what men in the occult do to Christian women. Okay, yeah, I'm under so much spiritual attack, I can even feel it now, even as I'm chatting over here. The next verse says, come and be the general in my army, mommy. So he's basically offering her a position of promotion if she will be his lover. If she will be with him, he will make her a respectable woman in society. Do you, dude? And then Simi sings again. Soldier, go home. Soldier, do what you want, but don't fall in love with me. Soldier, go. Soldier, come. Soldier, do what you want, but don't fall in love with me. Go listen to the song. I would love to play it, but it's copyright problems, right? And I don't want that issue. And then both Simi and False now are singing, right? And then she's like, this is Simi now speaking, Simi, the woman. She's like, Mr. Soldier, me a day wonder, she is it by force, you day form superpower. And then he's like, hey, I'm super, I get power, I get babes the age of your mama, so just stop, this is your drama. See this man, I say, your father, oh yeah, repeat, I'm your father. Oh, see me, see wala, I don't enter yawa. Oh yes, yeah, now you enter, is it by chance? I tell you, no man, and then this is now False, I tell you, no man overthrow man from this romance, only coup d'etat. Like, yeah, let me end this, is like, it'll kill you. The way that they say it is just, of course, I'm like butchering it, I'm like murdering it, I am disrespecting it, frankly. That's what's good. Okay, So Simi says, Mr. Soldier, me I day wonder. So she's like, Mr. Soldier, I'm wondering. Shay, is it by force? You day form superpower. He's like, so is it by force that you're gonna do this thing? Are you forming a superpower? And then his response is, me, I'm super. So he's basically saying, yeah, I'm super, okay? He's like, yeah, I'm super. I get power. He's just so forceful, so coercive. It's funny in the music video, but when it is a reality that you're experiencing as a woman, from a man like this, it's frankly destructive, it's murderous, it's psychopathy, it's stalking. And there is nobody that is a victim of stalking that is having a good time. It's not funny, it's uncomfortable for the person in question that is rational. So she's like, I've been, this dude in America, I've been asking him these same questions. Mr. Soldier of the Kingdom of Darkness, me I day wonder, she is it by force, you day form superpower. And his response is, yeah, I'm super. Like, yes, guys, it's just so coercive. It's, yo, my man. And you know, this music video, I tell her, Simi is in a village. She's hanging laundry on a washing line or bringing it down or whatever. Just a very basic village girl. And this guy's taking for granted the fact that she's a basic village girl. They literally look vele vele for you when you are struggling. They try to find something in your life that is lack or lacking. And then they use that. And when you are unmoved despite your poverty, they still insist, yo, ire form superpower, yeah, Kenya. Yeah, I'm super, I get power, we got paper, wafi shower, okay. Wagba paper, wafi shower, moti shower, that's like a simi. So I don't even know what that means, but I think he's saying, I will shower you with paper. So money, right? I get babes the age of your mama. Okay, that one is hilarious, but it's not. He's basically saying, every woman wants me. He's like, I get babes the age of your mama. I think that makes sense on its own. He's saying that he gets women the age of her mom. So just stop, this is your drama. So he says, just stop your drama. I get women the age of your mom, just stop your drama. See this man, I say your father. Oh yeah, I repeat, I'm your father. He's like, do you see me? I'm your father. Yo guys, yazi. This song is just so perfect to describe these false prophets all over the show. Like Prophet Lovi, for instance, Wambiza Papa. Him and Hubert Angel, him and Bushiri, him and something Tankedi, Walaims Anzi. They call them Papa, and the Bible says that nobody is the father. Don't call anybody Abba or Father or whatever, but the Father in heaven. Christ gives that rebuke. But these guys love to be called Papa. They call, like, if you go and listen to Prophet Lovi's deliverance sessions, people be out in these streets calling him Papa, Papa all over the show. It is disturbing. Do you understand what I'm saying? And this guy, false, is expecting this from this woman. This could literally be a gospel song that is a warrior song by women against men in the occult. To basically say, I belong to Jesus, I'm going to tell my papa, and he is going, I'm going to tell my mama going to tell my papa, oh, see me, see wa'ala, I'm not interested, but this soldier's like, I'm super, nobody's going to take me away from this romance, only coup d'etat. It's ridiculous. And false here is saying, I get babes, the hedge of your mama, so just stop, this is your drama, see this man, I say your father, oh yeah, repeat, I'm your father. So he's saying, do you look at me, do you see this man that's standing in front of you, I'm your father, I repeat, I'm your father. Like what? Oh, see me, see wala. I don't enter yawa. Oh, so see this man. I say your father. Oh yeah, repeat, I'm your father. That is see me singing. But this guy is saying to her, yo, I'm your papa. I'm your dad. So like, say, call me daddy. Yeah, exactly that. Like, call me daddy. Like, you know that whole, it's a sexual innuendo when men say to women, call me daddy. It's a turn on for them. And this guy's like, I'm your daddy. Well, according to the Bible, only one man is our dad in heaven above God. And we should not be romanticizing that or elevating it above anything. It is the hypersexualizing of a spiritual practice. And so of course it is taken up very much by men in the occult, especially those that are using occult powers to do miracles and signs and wonders. See this man, I say your father. Oh yeah, repeat, I'm your father. Oh, see me, see wala. I don't enter yawa. Oh, oh. So see me's like, no, I don't want to enter into this. Oh, oh, oh yes, yawa, where you enter. And then this is now false responding. False, the guy in the equation, he is like, oh yes, yeah, na yawa, where you enter. It's a one chance, and then this is where it kills me, right? So he says, you must enter this, you're only gonna get one chance, except he comes back 10,000 times. I tell you, no man overthrown man from this romance, only coup d'etat. He says that no man. This is the part where I remember earlier I told you guys in the earlier parts of this whole session of communicating, I said that these guys, when they want you, they will kill every man that you've ever loved, every man that you will ever love, every man that could potentially love you, every man that so much as winks at you or looks at you in a particular way, any man that greets you kindly, any man that looks in your direction, he will knock them out the way. He will shoot down any prospect of yours. Guys, yes, it's so disturbing. Like this dude in America, I've had so many dreams of him killing, what I would say, not killing, attempting to, and I've already given the prophecies concerning that, some white men that he put in. Yeah, have you seen the movie Cabin in the Woods? Cabin in the Woods. That's what's good. You know those monsters inside the elevator that's going up and down and whatnot? This man was inside one of those elevators and he was waiting an opportunity to be killed, massacred by all the other monsters in the cabin in the woods. And he was, it's almost as if though unless he got rescued out of that, he would inevitably die. And I had an understanding that that man was my husband. Committed so many death curses on a man he doesn't even know. So many. On a man, any man that could ever potentially be my husband. And every time God shows me some dude that is trapped in some rut by his witchcraft, which he is not, because you can't do that to Christians, but that's how they see things. It's always some white guy. Which is, I'm not saying that I'm going to get married to a white dude, but it's always been a white dude that has been trapped in this environment. So this dude would not just go out of his way to pull a rabbit out of his hat and make it the image of a white guy pop up, unless maybe the Lord is showing me that I am very likely going to end up married to a white man. I don't know. Yeah, I've seen dreams of that nature where any dude that could ever come in my grill just stumbled. Angibon. I've had a dream where I was an old woman. I've had this like evil. So what False is saying here is exactly what it is that this witchcraft of this dude in America and likely this other one that's looking at me is also doing. So I don't know what in the world they think in the occult. Like, Papa, you two or three of you are looking at the same woman. Who of you is gonna win exactly? Is it on rank? Or what are your imaginations in that regard? I don't know. Like, the loftier you are as an occult practitioner, then maybe you're the one that's going to be able to marry the Christian woman. I have fended off just about every Satanist that has ever tried to come all up in my grill to discourage those of you that are still looking at me. And one of them belonged to a whole secret society that was thriving. Some dude that I used to work with at MTN, another one. He used to belong to a whole organization that had earmarked him, chosen him to become something big in the future. And he was like a little young recruit that they were grooming. And I was able to ward that guy off successfully. He belonged to some organization that is quite powerful. So I don't know why this guy in America thinks that he's amateur. He does voodoo in his own little shrine. Like, why he's still carrying on, I don't know. Because now he is standing up against a guy that I believe belongs to such a prolific secret society that now he doesn't stand a chance at all with, like, his witchcraft, his love spell, death curse, love spell, death curse. He's not going to be able to stand. He's an amateur self-practicing witch that just every so often experiments with bouts of voodoo versus a man that I believe belongs to an organization that is very well organized, that does demonic activity. I believe him to be even a Freemason. What is this? This past evening, I had a dream of another Prophet Lovi. It's not Prophet Lovi. It can't be. But it's a man like him. The Lord is trying to explain caliber to me so that I can understand the kind of man that's looking at me. And he was trying to show me in that dream, that same Satanist, that same devil worshiper guy. He was trying to show me the life that he has right now. You know how I've got such a low opinion of people in the occult? How it is that they lose family, they have to sacrifice people. They are empty, barren of joy, ultimately, later on in life. And people start to suspect them of nonsense. This dude is in the interim phase of getting to a point of destruction. And so he has not lost very much. And so he is still a thriving uncle, a thriving member of society, like a brother, a son. He is still somewhat in a bunch in terms of his family. He has not sacrificed a whole lot of them or whatever. And I got a dream where I saw Prophet Lovi, you know, what it is that he is today, basically. Like, just like minus the wife, okay, because the wife is always just absent in my dream. So God is showing me a man that is like Prophet Lovi, but without the wife, because he wouldn't be trying to come into my life if he had, type thing. But he's trying to marry me, even though I do believe I would be like a second or third wife. Currently, however, he is divorced, just like what Prophet Lovi was prior to marrying that woman. A man that is somebody's son, somebody's dad, somebody's respected brother, uncle, a man that is somebody's, you get my point. Yeah, so he is loved and he gives family gifts and they love him. Everybody's just like, he's a thriving, looks like he's got meaning man. He's a man that looks like he's got meaning in life. And he's well respected. That's just the thing about occult practitioners. These men who gain power through demonic entities. It takes a very long time for them to be brought down. In yesterday's video, I was speaking about the eventuality of occult people. How money's not a motivator. And only later in life when they have lost their youth. They are out of their youth. They're prime. They're out of the glory of their youth. And it is in looking back now as a 60-year-old man. A 65-year-old man that you wish you'd never partook in the occult. But when you are still 28, 35, 40, 45 maybe, you are yet to crash and burn so badly that since You are still disrespectful. Do you understand? You still have the glory of your youth. You're still gorgeous. You're still beautiful. You're still handsome. And so you haven't gotten there. So the man that is looking at me is yet to crash and burn. The way that the curse of the black pearl crashes and burns a person. Yesterday, I was speaking about the curse of the black pearl in Pirates of the Caribbean, speaking about what witches are like. They're like people who steal gold, and then next thing they can't eat, they can't enjoy the touch of a woman, they can't enjoy anything anymore. It takes time to get there, and this guy hasn't gotten there yet. So he is trying to show me everything else around him. As, hey, look, I got meaning, I got family, I got love, I got respect, I got this, I still got my handsome, I got my whatnot. I'm not a typical occult practitioner that basically is just withered away and wasted at the end of her life. This thing has borne fruit for me, except what are you, like 42? Relax. Wait till you turn 53. Wait till you turn 60. Then you're gonna know that you messed up. Wait, maybe even till you turn 45, because that might be when you have sacrificed 3 more brothers and now you can't deal. Ultimately, it catches up with them, but before then, but youth. They get crazy over the acquisitions that they gain, money, pump and esteem and all that jazz. All these awards, rewards by society for being a powerful man. They get muddied in their mind concerning the continued prosperity of this until the very end. Only look at Benny Hinn, for instance. Prophet Lovie only needs to go and look at Benny Hinn. Look at how desperate he's looking, asking people for donations now that he's all old. Benny Hinn is a man that uses, obviously, occult magic for powers to slay people in the spirit and make everybody fall dead like that. You had to have done a contract with the devil because he is not truly of God. But look at Benny Hinn now. He's a shadow of himself. He's completely gone, and he's out here being embarrassed by his niece, or is it not niece, nephew, Kosti Hinn, who is a biblical Christian that has walked away from the health, wealth, and prosperity gospel. He is a of what he used to be. And it's now so evident, because he's an old man now. It's clear that he's gone. So all that you need to do, if you're looking at a person that appears to be thriving in darkness when they're still sort of kind of healthy looking, just look at yourself in Benny Hinn and understand that that is the end result of Prophet Lovie. It's inevitable. It is inevitable. That is going to be the end result of men that have dabbled with darkness and then sat around in the church, married, taken women that don't belong to them, because they used witchcraft and all that jazz. The end is never good. They must all just repent and do a better thing. Give their testimonies that are very shoddy. Testimonies are always beautiful, but speaking of shoddy things that they did, rather do that while you are still in your prime than make like indeed Benny Hinn, who upon realizing this thing did not pay off for all of 5 seconds, repented from the health, wealth, and prosperity gospel, and then he came back to it again. Like, don't wait until then. Just do it now when you're still glorious. Like, confess that you're a devil worshipper. Is that basic? And stop pursuing God's girls. Next part, while we finish that song. So the next lyric in the song, False says, right? I tell you, no man overthrown man from this romance, only coup d'etat. He's saying, no man has ever thrown me. No man will ever throw me from this romance, only coup d'etat. In other words, it's going to be a trial by ordeal. It's going to be some fight in the cosmos between 3 devil worshippers. And the one who wins is the one that's going to get the woman. So essentially, like the guy in America, once upon a time, I got a dream of him saying, I don't care how many guys want her, I'm gonna be the one to get her. That was after I did a video telling him about my ex-boyfriend, like the last guy I was with, in any kind of like reasonable relationship that is respectable. He tried to come back using witchcraft, because they always lean on sorcery. They stop shellaring, they stop, you know, pursuing things properly, sending an email, calling a person. They no longer do that. Now they basically make their paths straight. They try to make like God, but supernaturally they make their paths straight before they come in. So a guy has already cast a spell on you before he asks you out. Imagine that. Whatever happened to good old-fashioned stumbling around over your words and then asking a girl for a number? Whatever happened to buying flowers? Whatever happened to romantic gestures? Now the romantic gesture is literally setting the ground in a woman's heart such that she will agree to be with you using witchcraft. Like, well, who lives in a world like that? Hey guys, anyway, whatever. So this guy's like, I'm telling you, nobody's going to throw me from this romance, only a coup d'etat. So another man is going to have to basically kill me out the way, another sorcerer. So basically men who are not involved in satanic arts, so men who are not in darkness, can dream on like a regular Joe on the street that's not a Christian, that thinks you're cute. they don't even stand a chance. They are the ones that are going to be made to not see you. The ones that are going to be made to, when they look at you, they see an old woman. When they look at you, they see an upside down story. Or all of a sudden they get turned off from you. Or the moment they talk to you, they get a dream that turns them off and they run. These are guys in the world, men in the world, who are made to just be turned off from you the moment they even so much as try to talk to you. What has happened in my life personally, I will explain after this guy's witchcraft. I stopped getting DM'd on Facebook. First of all, when I was on my old Facebook, I stopped getting friend requests when this guy was talking to me, because he wanted nobody talking to me. And then I started a page on Facebook, and I walked away from my old Facebook because it had a whole bunch of my former friends, and they were disrespecting me, ignoring me, treating me like trash, a lot of persecution. So I walked away from my old life and I started a new life and a new page on Facebook. However, I was getting direct messages every so often from random guys on some hi, like, you know, these stupid hi DMs and whatnot. Got guys trying to holla at you. Yeah, well, this dude hooked up a spell to basically say, I tell you, no man, overthrown man from this romance, only coup d'etat. He was like, no man is gonna look at you. So I literally stopped direct messages from every guy. Like, there was a guy that used to consistently DM me. He would first write a comment on something that I said, and then he would DM me and have like a neutral conversation, trying really to worm his way in. I used to respond to DMs until I stopped, okay? But the guys that I had responded to the direct messages of, I did not stop responding to them when they would write me again, because I considered it rude to do so, since I had already spoken to them before. They are guys that used to consistently DM me just to be like, hey Karabo, how you doing today? I hope you're well, my sister in Christ. Even though I could tell they were not really born again, even they stopped DMing me. Literally everybody stopped direct messaging me, even the ones I used to have thriving conversations. There was a man that used to email me in the name of Jesus or whatever. He went awry, and so I told him to just kind of like slow down and take, like, just give, yeah. But initially he was fellowshipping with me very neutrally, and it appeared as if though he didn't want anything. It was an older white guy, sent me even a donation and stuff like that. I was grateful, continued to talk. Every so often he would send me links of Christian prophecy all over the world, stuff going on, the rapture coming, articles to read, stuff like that, that kind of fellowship. Yeah, that dude also suddenly disappeared. He suddenly disappeared after the spell where this guy was literally like, I tell you, no man overthrow man from this romance, only coup d'etat. That man was not even trying to holler at me. He did go awry in some strange way, but he wasn't trying to be with me. He wasn't trying to be with me. And despite that, just because he was a man that was DMing me, emailing me, we were talking over email. So I had even given him my email address. Every man that has ever DM'd me stopped. And now I don't get DM'd at all. Like, it's dead quiet, tumbleweed. It's like nobody likes me. It's like, it's horrible. What's going on there? These are worldly men. The guy I told you that was sending me prophecies and links and whatnot, he was lukewarm. So it worked on him. That's what I'm trying to explain to you guys. He was lukewarm, so it prospered to sever him from my ecosystem. So long story short, what these men do is rescue the Christian from like random pursuit, deadbeat pursuit that is not going to go anywhere. Like, men that are just going to be like wasting time, lukewarm, or they like a Christian woman and like, hi, how you doing, my sister, in the name of Jesus, when they don't know Christ, because they can tell that you've got a lot of Christianese on your tongue. So because you speak as much Christianese, they then try to holler at you also speaking Christianese. How you doing in the name of Jesus, my sister? Yes, but they don't know Christ from above. So even those annoying guys that are innocent but not really, because they're lost, they need to get born again, but they're not dabbling with darkness, they're not doing witchcraft, they're not trying to force a woman into their life, they're the ones that are gonna be, they get blown away quickly by witchcraft like that. It works on them. They all of a sudden just disappear. They get warded off, turned off from ever talking to somebody. And what tends to happen in this environment, I would imagine, is stuff like they get dreams. And these dreams are telling them, leave Karabo alone. Or something, Jefela, in them is turned off. Or something happens. And then they suddenly just switch off. So you go from being this popular girl that every guy's DMing to now it's just dead quiet, like tumbleweed all up in your grill. As a Christian woman, it's good riddance. Because I don't want an ungodly man pursuing me anyway. I don't want a man that's not in Christ pursuing me anyway. But if you are a woman in the world, and you go from being very popular, every man wants you, to now nobody's even trying to talk to you, nobody's looking at you, and the crush that you were busy flirting with in the office now is avoiding you. No eye contact. When he sees you, he ubalekhisa amahlo. It can break your heart. It can break your heart. It can make you feel like, what I do? Do I smell? What's happening? Is it my armpits? Is it my breath? What's going on? You will feel worthless. You will feel worthless. All of a sudden, nobody will want you. When yesterday, guys were literally queuing, lining up outside of your house, you know, petition for your... So, yeah, look out for these signs, women. I'm just saying, when you have met a man like this, he will turn you off. Every man in your life, even if it's your boss, your boss will suddenly pass you shade. He doesn't want anybody looking at you. It could be just a friendly teacher at your little sister's school will all of a sudden not even want to look at you. It could be the at the grocery store that used to talk to you and basically scan your groceries slowly so that he could continue to talk to you for 5 extra minutes, and he will now like not even look you in the eye anymore. He will just be avoiding you, and you are like, what's going on? And this will happen with every man that so much as looks at you with favor, the things that these guys do. So if you are a Christian woman, it's good riddance, because it makes sure that ungodly men can't touch you. They won't look at you, they won't pursue you. So it really just kind of funnels down the dating field. Do not let it kill your self-confidence. If you're an ungodly woman or a woman that is not saved, you're gonna feel like nobody loves you anymore, and you're not gonna know what's going on because you have not trusted Jesus. And the only men that will still want to pursue you are ones who will be vying for you in the same sport Nefarious Beast is in. In other words, another devil worshiper is the only true competition for this guy that's all up in your grill. Because they fight each other in the cosmos with spiritual weapons. He will be able to see what's coming up against you. And he will also then be like, I'm going to knock this guy out and then I'm going to take Garabo. So I've been talking on the rooftops about this guy in America. And he is going to get knocked out of the way by an even more prolific devil worshiper. I told you, some other Satanists are going to kill this American man. Be out of entitlement for me. And I had made mention of the fact that it's going to be occultists in South Africa that are going to do this in my country. So I told you that the other guy that I don't know about that is similar to Prophet Lovi, I don't know where he's from, right? But one thing that the Lord showed me is that some other devil worshippers are going to neutralize the American dude. So it might be a guy from South Africa or elsewhere in the world, I don't know. But he is a devil worshipper that is far loftier in his authority or position in the occult than this amateur in the US with voodoo. So he does not stand a chance. I keep seeing this voodoo guy Waco America in the flames of hell as a gorilla, like as a whole animal. Like old school. I used to have these cousins growing up that used to wear old school mapanzola gear, like 90s mapanzola gear. Every time I see a man wearing a 1990s fashion in the mapanzola category, that's the Lord showing me a guy that's in the past and he's not coming back. So I know that I have already conquered a man. I know that I've already conquered somebody that is a male. If at all he rocks up in my dreams wearing the apparel tsa mapanzola tsa mantariana tsa back in the 90s, because those clothes always remind me of trompies. They always remind me of my cousin that used to be lepanzola back in the day. It reminds me of the 90s, like what fashion, what popular guys in the 90s in South Africa used to dress like. But it's something from long ago. And recently as about a week ago, I had a dream where finally the guy from the US finally was wearing mapanzola clothes. I was like, whoa, I conquered him. He's in the past now. He's gone and done and dusted. But he has been taken over by a Prophet Lovi spirit. Like some dude that is like Prophet Lovi has knocked this guy into mapanzola. He's knocked him into the 90s. He's knocked him into something from long ago that's never coming back again. Well, I don't think, is he still alive? I don't know what's going on with the dude in America, but he's not going to be a problem anymore in my life, precisely because of the Prophet Lovi tantamount that is looking at me. And this is because this guy is in a loftier position in the occult. So those are the only competitors that can ever come up against a person that has cast a spell on you. So essentially, you will, once you have had such a spell cast on you as a woman, the only men that will be vying for your affection are in the occult. Imagine that. If you're lost, it is only devil worshippers that can win your heart, because they will fight each other's witchcraft to eventually get you. But there's a category of men that have not been accounted for in this equation, and it's Christian men. truly blood-bought, born-again men are not subject to the spells that are cast on worldly men that will ignore you, not talk to you anymore in the store, pass you shade, not look at you when you are talking to them anymore because something strange happened or they got a funny dream. They've got discernment, they've got the Holy Spirit, and they are not just subject to the tyranny of random witchcraft. So that's why I say that this guy in America basically saved me irritation from direct messages from random dudes on the internet that did not know God. It just made everything quiet. But I also have not been emailed by a godly man either. I'm not being looked at by a godly man either, but I'm definitely not being looked at by ungodly men because he has warded them off. So I'm safe. But for men in the occult, as for Christian men, if at all the Lord has seen it fit to put one in my, to make one look at me, he will do that, just like with Isaac and Rebecca. And no spell is going to take this. Nothing can separate. What is this? If the Lord has put stuff together, nothing can by any means separate it. What the Lord has put together, no man can separate, no man can bring asunder. So if a godly man was set apart or consecrated to be my husband, none of these spells would be meaningful at all in his general growth. But I did let you guys know that I'm not getting married on this side of the rapture. I have said it over and over again. So I'm not even expecting for God to raise up a bit of an Isaac with me being Rebecca that's going to conquer all of these death, not death curses, but all of these hide garabo from all men spells. I'm not waiting for a man. That's what you must understand. I am not expecting marriage at all. So I'm not looking out for any man to come through. Therefore, any man that would ever attempt to come through at this point, given the amount of witchcraft that has been done on worldly men, that is in operation from all of these spell casters, it will inevitably be a devil worshipper. Every man going forward from today that will ever try to holler at me will inevitably be a devil worshipper. They're the only ones that can look at me with any level of prosperity without being knocked out the way by some spells, because they're busy in and of themselves practicing spells. So I keep dreaming about them. I keep seeing infiltration by men in the darkness. And I'm like, yeah, of course, all the way up until Christ raptures us as the body of Christ, I will keep on getting pursued by nothing but men. I will be looked at for romantic prospects by men, and they're not going to easily just write me or slide into my DMs. They're going to try and water me down, soften me up somehow. They're first going to look to see who else is vying for me, try to knock them out the way, following which they then will focus on me. And all I can say to them is, soldier, go, soldier, come, soldier, do what you want, but don't fall in love with me. The devil is literally showing his servants my ministry to somehow try to water me down. I have had so many demonic attacks sexually, so many rapey dreams, so many, it's sexual abuse, like force coming from the occult. I know how to spot Corobella from a mile away. It is always full of lust. It's always full of sexual suggestion. When a man is busy kissing me, caressing me, trying to have sex with me in a dream, that is Corobella. It's Corobella in the worst way. Like, I see it all the time, but they never prosper to get to the point where I'm having sex with them. They never prosper to get there, but they do try to seduce me in my dreams. And when I wake up, I'm like, I get exhausted. Their witchcraft looks exactly the same. They're using an ancient spirit that never changes his colors. It's the exact same thing. And I know when it's happening, and the effects of it are cataclysmic. The effects of it are quite cataclysmic. They're catastrophic because I get depressed, guys. I get visited with, it's a very coercive witchcraft, right? In the sense that it's saying, take it or else. So there's a lot of death. There are elements of death to it. A lot of elements of absent of accepting this, it's over for you. Yes, exactly like the song. Yeah, false. Lisimi. In the beginning, he says here that, what is this? I'm talking to you. Why aren't you responding? You're going to date me. I am a soldier, so I can't be a servant. You can't, you know, to you, you are going to take me no matter what. And if you don't take me, nobody else will want you. It is extremely coercive. So I get overwhelmed with lots and lots of despair. In the beginning of this whole chat session, I spoke about how it is that I conquered with a passage from God's word, and how it is that I was attacked by certain kinds of dreams, and I knew that it was a demon. I knew that it was demons that were afflicting me, because that's not how I think. So they were trying to make me change my mind. And I will tell you now what it is that the mind change was gunning for. But let's finish these lyrics. Oh, I tell you, no man overthrow man from this romance, only coup d'etat. These men literally understand that nobody can ever stop them from pursuing a woman. And no one will ever want this woman. She will spend the rest of her life alone. Unless another guy slaps me out the way. Unless another man like me slaps me out the way. So it becomes a spiritual battle between two devil worshippers for one woman. And who, again, it's one of those, may the best men win. So they enter into Fight Club because they think they're Brad Pitt. And whoever wins is the one that gets the lady. So they're literally acting like brute beasts in the wilderness. They're acting like animals in the wild. Do you understand what I'm saying? That are vying for a mate. And they are treating a woman like an animal that can be had by any of the men in this beastly fight that is animalistic that wins. Yeah, I could say a hamster or a lion, some kind of a beast in the wilderness that really frankly the best man is the one that gets to mate with her. Imagine somebody looking at you like that. It's just so much sexual abuse. It is so abusive. That's how men in the occult roll. And this is what they subject women to. And women in the world are pawn chips on their little chessboard. That's what you must understand. So if you don't give your life to Christ as a woman, you don't know how many men, like especially if you're like the most beautiful girl in the school or the most viable, like the new intern in the office that's causing a whole bunch of guys to spaz. Dare you get looked at by some dude that's a devil worshipper, that's practicing darkness, that's working in the office. All of a sudden you will go from being popular, every guy wants you, every guy in the office is trying to ask you out. Next thing it goes dry. Next thing there are only two or three guys that are still trying to pursue you. And all of them are in the occult. And they will literally knock each other out until the best man wins and becomes the dude to ask you out. You go on a date with him and you end up literally dating another boyfriend, your devil worshipper, and you don't even know it. All of a sudden nobody else is even trying to look at you. Like that can cause some self-confidence issues. So women, you really need to give yourselves to Christ. Because if you don't do that, you don't know who in the world out here in these streets has made out of you a chess piece. A chess piece that men are playing with. Just playing with in the spirit. To win you. Gan. Like little psychopaths. Batloho stalker. But this is about Christian women and how it is that these guys absolutely are besotted and beside themselves with adoration for women that are entirely out of their league, not supposed to be theirs, because they're God's daughters, but they want them anyway because, like I said, cut above the rest. Many women have done excellently, but she surpasses them all. So then Simi goes on to say, soldier go, soldier come, soldier do what you want, but don't fall in love with me. Soldier me, I know they do. Soldier find another boo, just don't fall in love with me. Soldier me, I know they do. Soldier me, I know they do. So don't you fall in love. Money, don't you fall in love with me. With me. Don't you fall in love. Yeah, yeah. The song ends. So Simi is basically saying to False at this point, soldier, do what you want. Do what you want. Like, find another boo. Find another woman. But not me. All the counsel that I can ever give to these randos in the occult who don't want Jesus, because they're the wicked set apart for the day of the trouble of the church. Do you, if you want longevity, however, until the second coming of Jesus Christ, stay away from Christian women. Otherwise, they will be the end of you. They will literally sever in half your life expectancy. You will die because of being obsessed with a Christian woman. That's exactly what's happened to this guy from America. His life expectancy has been severely cut. Precisely because of him making a decision to fall in love with a Christian woman. They put themselves in harm's way by falling in love with women that are out of their league. You cannot build yourself up to suddenly be a man fit and respectable for a godly woman when you've been dabbling, practicing in the occult for years. And now you meet a godly woman and you think that you can for 5 seconds sing half a little prayer to God to give you a woman that has been waiting on the Lord for a man that prayed for a wife, prayed for her to be okay, and also for her to come into his life, that searched the world to find that godly girl, that in and of himself sought the Lord's face to give him character that he might be a fit husband for a woman like that, that he might be able to love her as Christ loved the church, like a man that literally went to husband school for years, trained up a particular woman that went to wife school in heaven. And you think that you can just rock up as a lechadima, little lightning strike from the occult, and separate that union. You think you can rock up as a little lightning bolt from the occult and take away from a woman that has been to wife school in heaven for 10 years and a man that's been to husband school in heaven for 12 years and just like make sure their marriage doesn't happen. It's naive. It is naive in the worst way to imagine that you can quickly just dust yourself off, like just quickly remove all the grime of the occult and then take a woman that's been groomed for a king. Take a woman that has been groomed for royalty and as a peasant quickly wear king's robes that you bought, what do you call this, like a costume store, and then make shift as a disciple and just take this woman that has been, like I said, trained by God for years, groomed for a king. So she essentially is very discerning. She is prayerful. She is alert, sober, vigilant. And you think a woman like that, she's awake, is not going to be able to quickly pick up that you are wearing king's robes that you bought from a costume store, knit for you very uniquely in heaven by God to fit just your body. She will spot you within 2 weeks of dating you. She will spot you within 5 seconds of talking to you. She will be able to know that from your belly is not flowing rivers of living water. You will shoot yourself in the foot. You will manifest demons. It will be clear that you don't make sense, and she will be the one to walk away. But by then, soldier, you have fallen in love with the wrong girl. Soldier, find another boo. So really, men in the occult, I would hugely advise you, if you want any level of longevity at all to roll around in your shores, stop going to churches to find wives. Because one day you might fall in love with a true Christian and date her for 1 month, maybe three. And then she will leave you because she will realize you are dark and you will never be able to let go. And she will be the end of your life because all the spells that you will cast to try and block her from meeting a man that has been groomed in heaven for 20 years, you will literally think that you can kill him before he comes into her life. When in and of himself, he is a fiery servant of the living God. In and of himself, he is shooting darts into the enemy's camp. In and of himself, he is wearing the full armor of God. In and of himself, he is trained, educated. In and of himself, he is discerning. In and of himself, he is prayerful. In and of himself, he is a force to be reckoned with in the kingdom of darkness, to the kingdom of darkness and in the kingdom of light. In and of himself, he is a beast. You cannot bring him low. And so your attempt is going to neutralize. Your attempt is going to kill you. So if you still want another 10 years on your meager, measly occult life, if you still want another 20 years, if you still want to see your children grow and get grandchildren, if you still want to see the first gray hair pop on your beard and on your head, you will leave the Christian girls alone if you're involved in darkness. However, you are involved in darkness, and then you make an observation of how excellent God's daughters are, and you want one, forget about the one that you have a crush on because she's already somebody else's wife. She is already far too big for you to take her. Get saved in and of yourself, and then enroll in husband school in heaven. Get out of Hogwarts. Drop out of Hogwarts. You Harry Potter there that is sitting, chilling, learning how to do magic. Literally, leave Hogwarts. Forget about the fees you have paid there. Forget about everything you have invested. Forget about even the fact that you were busy doing your doctoral dissertation at Hogwarts, the way that you were so advanced as a sorcerer. Dump it all and start from scratch from grade naught, and then grade 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. First year, second year, third year, fourth year. Honors, master's, doctorate in Christ. Proper. Do the time, and then the Lord will give you a wife in due season. If at all you've made an observation of how amazing God's daughters are and you are studying at Hogwarts, drop out, walk away, forget about your fees, leave everything behind, and be a new creation. And then the Lord will give you a woman similar to the one that you had a crush on 10 years ago. Patience is a fruit of the Holy Spirit. You're going to have to wait for your bride. You're going to have to wait for your time. And even then, if you're chilling in Hogwarts and you identify a godly woman, you don't get to want one when you are married. You also don't get to want one when you are divorced and your former spouse is still alive. You don't get to want one when those are your statistics. I am only speaking right now about Hogwarts graduates that are single, have never been married. Only you stand a chance of ever getting a godly woman. But first, you got to get born again and then trained so you can be in a position to be spiritually loftier than a woman, so it would be appropriate for you to marry her. But as for me, I'm being pursued by former spouses of people, by current husbands of people, by randos that are out here trying to leave Hogwarts join God's husband school, even though they've already been husbands. I'm sorry, you don't get a do-over in that regard. The scriptures are clear. Marital unfaithfulness, it is declared. If you marry, divorce, and remarry, it is called adultery. You don't get to take a second wife. You don't get to make like Marcus Rogers. You don't get to make like Prophet Lovi. You don't get to do any of that and still be okay in the sight of God. You made your bed, lie in it, I guess, at this point, upon observing the glory of the daughters of God. Yours is to then embrace celibacy for the rest of your days if you have a woman that you have divorced in the past, or you could just go back to that woman and then raise her up in the admonition of the Lord, train her up, make her godly so that you can love her the way that you absolutely are besotted with the Proverbs 31 woman that you spotted from a mile away and decided to throw a fiery dart of the enemy at her because it doesn't work that way. Accidents like that. Guys in the occult, loss ons. But no, y'all ain't losing ons. Instead, what you're doing is wearing us out with demonic attack. And all of this demonic attack has caused a sister to be in so much despair that she couldn't even sleep. And when she woke up in the middle of the night, having been wrenched out of sleep by a demonic entity, I was in so much despair that I had to basically lay awake, rolling, tossing and turning, watching random videos on YouTube until the sun rose. And only was I able to sleep at around 8 in the morning after repeating one scripture in my mind. We will demolish arguments and every lofty pretension that exalts itself above the Most High, and hold into captivity every thought to the obedience of Jesus Christ. I kept on saying that on a loop. Demolish arguments and every lofty imagination that exalts itself above the Most High, and hold into captivity every thought to the obedience of Jesus Christ. I had to rescue my mind from mind attacks in the night by a demon that was making me think in a way that I don't generally. Now let's go into this final part of me talking to explain to you guys what it is that I was made to think all night long, when that's not how I think, because I belong to an eternal heaven. I belong to an eternal kingdom that is not that petty.